Carl combines clinical care, health insurance, and research in a way that solves problems today with an eye toward the future. Supported by a deep philanthropic spirit and dedicated to making life better for as many as possible.
Meeting the ever-changing healthcare needs of our communities, Paris Community Hospital Family Medical Center is now Horizon Health, with the same ownership, management, providers, and employees. Horizon Health provides patient care and promotes wellness to the communities of East Central Illinois.
At HSHS St. Anthony's Memorial Hospital, we are at work transforming heart care, rebuilding knees and hips, delivering new generations, and focused on providing health care to you. We are HSHS St. Anthony's Memorial Hospital.
Sarah Bush Lincoln Health System, supporting healthy lifestyles, eating a heart-healthy diet, staying active, managing stress, and regular checkups are ways of reducing your health risks. Proper health is important to all at Sarah Bush Lincoln Health System.
Hi, I'm Kian Armstrong, your host for Being Well. Thank you so much for watching today. Today I have Lee Weber, a CRNA, joining me today, and we are going to be talking about pain management, something that most people deal with but maybe don't know how to live with. So we're going to be discussing a few different things and a couple of different types of pain management. So thanks so much for joining me today.
You're welcome.
So let's start off with, you're with Horizon Health in Paris, and you're a CRNA, is that right?
Correct.
So can you explain to folks what a CRNA is?
Sometimes CRNA will be on our badges, or you'll meet a CRNA, but nobody's really sure what that is. Mm-hmm. We're anesthesia providers. It stands for Certified Registered Nurse Anesthetist. And again, we're the anesthesia providers for most rural health communities. Most of rural health America is, we're the sole anesthesia providers in those facilities, and we're able to bring anesthesia services, pain management services, obstetrical services to those areas simply because there's not enough anesthesiologists or physician anesthesiologists to, they're located more in the cities where there's higher, more acuity types of surgeries being done. So we do a lot of the rural health stuff, and often, like I said, are the sole providers, and that is the case at Paris. There are four CRNAs at Paris, and we all do surgical anesthesia as well as some chronic pain management outside of the clinic.
So. Yeah, no anesthesiologists on staff,
correct,
but four CRNAs.
Correct.
Yeah, that's interesting. A difference between rural and city type of providing health and different,
yes,
services.
And you'll find CRNAs as well. You'll find them in any facility or place where there is anesthetics being provided, dentist's office, podiatrist's office, as well as in the traditional OR suite setting. But in the larger areas, bigger hospitals, cities, you'll find it more of a what they call a team care model. So you'll,
okay,
have some anesthesiologists as well as multiple CRNAs on site. So you'll likely run into an anesthesiologist during your pre-op interview. And then in the room during your anesthetic for the case will actually be a CRNA sitting with you and tracking your vitals on the monitor and making the adjustments there. So a lot of people are just unaware that we're kind of around. We've been around for a long time, 150 years.
Really?
We were the first ones doing anesthesia on the battlefield in the Civil War is,
okay,
where they really first kind of came about, primarily in World War I, and then it sort of became a real credentialed type thing around the 1950s. So.
Yeah, that's interesting because when you think of anesthesiology, you just think of going into surgery and someone, mm-hmm, putting you to sleep. You don't think about all the different things we're going to discuss today.
Mm-hmm.
So we're here to talk about pain management. We're going to be talking about acute as well as chronic. So
right,
which would you like to start talking about?
Let's start with acute.
Okay.
So when someone's coming and they're going to be having a surgery,
mm-hmm,
you're talking about that acute pain that they're going to be dealing with. Acute meaning short-lived, we know exactly what's causing it and we're expecting it. So you're coming in for a shoulder surgery, you've hurt your shoulder, we,
mm-hmm,
know you're there to get it fixed, and we know you're going to have some pain surrounding this shoulder surgery and getting through the recovery of that, especially in that first 24, 48, 72 hour period. And so what can we do as anesthesia, mm-hmm, providers to help control your pain to get you through that experience in the best way possible so that you have a nice comfortable experience and you're also maintaining range of motion of your shoulder and the things that the surgeon is wanting in order to expedite your healing and make sure that the shoulder heals in the way that they're wanting it to. So a shoulder surgery, a lot of times, and this is what they'll find still some at some facilities, which is kind of mind-boggling to me, but you'll go and just get put to sleep, mm-hmm. have your shoulder surgery, and wake up. You're going to have a lot of pain if you do it that way. A shoulder surgery is one of the most painful surgeries
do. I have had it, and there's a lot of pain involved.
There's a lot of pain with shoulder surgery, and it takes a long time to recover. You don't want to move it very much.
Yeah.
And so some things that we can do, the biggest of which would be a peripheral nerve block.
Okay.
So we can insert a shot of some numbing medicine around the nerves above the level of the shoulder. Turn those nerves off for a while so that mm-hmm. you're not feeling pain or anything in this whole arm that we're working on here.
Okay.
And what we like to do...
We're going to show a little example of something
here. Yep, I brought this catheter. Okay. If we give you just one shot for your shoulder surgery, you'll typically get pain relief, good pain relief, for about 12 to 24 hours.
Oh.
That gets you through. That's great. It gets you through the first 24 hours.
Yes.
But a lot of times that... it's going to be wearing off in the middle of the night mm-hmm. when you first go home, if you're doing it outpatient. And shoulder surgery is really painful past the first 24 hours. So what we like to do is before we take that needle out, we go ahead and we thread a little catheter and we leave that catheter in right by the nerves, hook it up to this tubing with a little regulator that we can control how fast it goes, and then we fill this with more of that numbing medicine
okay.
in this ball, and then you go home with this in a nice little fanny pack that you just wear and carry around with you, and it will continue giving you that numbing medicine, dripping that on that nerve, keeping that nerve turned off for the length of however long we have medicine in this, which usually lasts about 3 to 4 days.
Okay.
So we use this a lot as a tool as anesthesia providers to really help with pain control. We find when we use a peripheral nerve block, we give way less narcotics, way less pain medicines, both intra-op during the procedure and post-operatively when they wake up in recovery room. If they have a nerve block, especially with a catheter, a lot of times they wake up and they don't need any pain medicine at all. They go home, maybe they take one or two, and some patients take none at all, and they get through that first 3 days. So that's a really, really good tool for us.
Is that something new?
No, it's been around for a while. It's just not, you have to have anesthesia providers that mm-hmm. know how to place the block. And so there's some training and skill involved there. And so some centers will have providers that know how to do that and other places won't. So.
Okay. I have a note here that says that you have WEIU-TV clinical mm-hmm. site. So are you teaching other people how to use things such as that?
Yes,
then?
Our site in Paris mm-hmm. is a clinical site for the anesthesia school at Southern Indiana University, Edwardsville,
all
just
right.
at the north side of St. Louis. And so they will send their senior anesthesia students who are just about to graduate through different clinical rotations. Ours is specific for them learning how to do different types of peripheral nerve blocks because they don't get that a lot at some of their other clinical sites. So they come and we try to get them as many blocks, learning how to do these blocks as they can. We use ultrasound so we can image and see where our needle's going, see where we end up placing our catheter. So it's just kind of it takes a little bit of practice to
yes.
utilize, you know, the needling techniques and using the ultrasound and knowing what you're looking at on the screen. So
okay.
they come specifically for that, and that's what we try to get them.
All right. Will the patient need to go back to have it removed? And also, can that be put on different parts of your body, say your back or your hip, knee, is it something that
sure.
can be used more so on other body parts?
Yes. To your first question, the patients, I would say, remove the catheter themselves about
okay.
95% of the time. We tell them on discharge, if they don't feel comfortable removing that catheter, absolutely, they can come in, we'll do it for them. It's usually, depending on what site of the body we've placed that catheter, it could be anywhere from 2 centimeters to 10 centimeters. And it's, again, a really, really small catheter. And you just sort of pull it out. There shouldn't be any bleeding. There might be a little back leaking of some of this numbing medicine that we put in there, but you can just put a Band-Aid over it, and that's about it. To your question of parts of the body, yes, we can do different types of blocks. The ones that we're going to be using these catheters for that the patients will send home usually have to be on an appendage of some sort, so on an arm or a leg, or so that would include ankles and knees and hips.
All right.
If you're talking about a truncal surgery, a laparoscopic surgery, we can also place those blocks, but they are typically not patients that are going home. Those are typically going to be your inpatient surgeries, and then the nurse would remove the catheters at that point.
All right, so how do you treat chronic pain?
Okay, so if we're moving to chronic pain, we're talking now about some patients that are having pain. Lower back pain is a big one that we deal with.
Yes.
So many people have lower back pain. Knee pain is probably the second largest one we get referrals for.
Okay.
Pain that's not associated with a particular insult, a particular surgery you just had, or an injury that you just had. Pain you've been dealing with now for months, years, in a lot of cases. You've tried multiple things to try to help that out, and you're just not getting anywhere with that. So these are the patients we'll see in our chronic pain clinic. Paris has a chronic pain clinic that started about 9 years ago.
All right.
Started very small, and there was just two anesthetists there at the time. They mostly just treated some disc bulges and sciatica type mm-hmm. symptoms, chronic lower back pain and pain into the legs starting from the back. They would do a few injections in the back, and it was started very small. Now we're on a much bigger scale. We do a whole lot more interventions.
Right.
There's different types of injections that we can do. And so we usually just start with seeing how long they've had their pain and where it started.
All right. So we're talking about lower back hurting, and you hear a lot of people say, gosh, when my back hurts, I just hurt all over and I just mm-hmm. can't get any relief. So then how do you talk to that patient about what's going to happen?
We usually get these patients into our clinic. They usually are coming from some sort of primary care provider, their family practice physician, their mm-hmm. internal medicine physician. And they'll show up in our clinic, and they'll usually already have an MRI, some sort of imaging that mm-hmm. shows on their back what's going on. So we use that information as well as just working with those patients in the office, putting them through a few different exams in the office to try to... Back pain is very difficult to diagnose. There's a lot of things that can cause back pain, a lot of different things. So we have to use a combination of our exam skills and the imaging to try to do some detective work to try to figure out what's actually causing
right.
that pain.
Well, especially if they've had it for a long time too.
Right, right. And so I have another little model here of the back.
All right.
We've got different
Let's take a look at this.
Portions. So just a model of the spine that we're using. And we've got different things. These are the discs that lie in between the vertebra of the spine. Those are our shock absorbers and our cushion. And they're normally supposed to be set up with a little bit of a jelly-like substance on the inside, and then there's sort of an annular ring of a tougher substance on the outside. As we get older, this disc can degenerate or sort of just kind of wear away.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing you can see happening in this one is this inner substance is, don't pay attention to the color, that doesn't really matter, but you can see it's starting to kind of push its way out over here.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get to the point here where you may have this inner jelly-like substance squirting way out. And so you can go all the way from just having a simple disc bulge where the disc is just sort of pushing out of where it's supposed to be. It's been irritated and it's pushing backwards on the spinal cord and on these spinal nerve roots that are coming out. All the way to an extrusion or a herniation of that inside substance. So all of those different things can cause you some back pain, as well as just this little joint right here, which is called the facet joint. And it's just where these stack on top of each other. You'll have some pain in that bony area right there.
All right.
And right here. Those are facet joints, and you'll have arthritis as you get older mm-hmm. into those areas. The pain from those areas is usually just achy, chronic back pain.
Mm-hmm.
The pain from a bulging disc or something that's pushing on a nerve root, you're probably gonna have symptoms on down your leg. You're gonna have either numbness of a lower leg extremity or pain shooting down the backside of your leg. And so we need to tease out what is the source of your pain. And often patients have multiple sources of their pain. So then we work on trying to tease out what is the most irritating part of their pain
yes.
at that moment, or the most important to fix interventionally at that time. What's the biggest risk towards them? If you keep pressure on that spinal cord for a long time, that's not a good thing. So we want to make sure that we take care of that first before we work on just the arthritis in the back.
Okay, so talk about some options that patients can receive treatment or pain remedy. What do you do? So if it's something that is like that bulging or the mm-hmm. pressing on a nerve or the little joint there. Mm-hmm. Talk to us about some of the different things that you actually do to help that patient deal with that pain.
So again, typically by the time they've seen us, the primary care provider has already put them through some sort of course of physical therapy. Mm-hmm. That's a good thing to start at the beginning.
Create mobility.
A lot of times with some particular exercises that they put them through, a lot of times laying on the stomach and doing some extension of the spine exercises, you can kind of get that disc bulge to go back if it's not a really big one. It hasn't been there for very long and it's still fairly mobile. Other things that we'll like to see them have tried is an over-the-counter anti-inflammatory of some sort, not just pain meds. So a lot of times we'll get pain patients who are just on pain medicines, mm-hmm. but they've never tried an anti-inflammatory. The order, if you're having back pain, would be to get mobile, ice, rest in between your mobility and stretching, try an over-the-counter anti-inflammatory.
All right.
From there, which is typically the point that we receive these patients, then we can look at doing something a little bit on down the pathway. We can give them a prescription strength anti-inflammatory. Try that for a little bit. We can give them some other types of medicines, antispasmodics or muscle relaxant mm-hmm. type medicines, other neuropathic medicines like gabapentin or Lyrica are good to try at the beginning. And then if they're still not getting relief, then we usually take them to the OR and do some sort of spinal injection, like an epidural steroid injection mm-hmm. or an ablation injection or something like that to try to help that disc bulge to get better or that arthritis to get better.
All right. So looking at a timeline of folks who come in and say, gosh, I've lived with this for so many years, I just want this to go away. Going through these different varieties of options, what kind of timeline can you give people an idea of, okay, we're going to start out with this, we're going to do the physical therapy leading up to where, you know, you hear a lot of people actually getting those shots. Mm-hmm. So kind of how long on average?
So the first thing to help patients understand when they first come in is that if you're coming in and you've had back pain, chronic lower back pain for 10 years, mm-hmm. I'm not going to be able to fix it in a month.
Right.
I can't give you one injection, one pill, and you're going to be good to go for the rest of your life. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it's just helping them get a realization of these are the things we need to do. And really the interventional tools that we use, both the medications that we use, the pills, and the injections in the back, they're all to try to help get the patient over in not so much pain that they are right now so that they can then feel better to then do the things that they need to do to continue their back health for the rest of their life. So maybe they tried to go to PT, but they mm-hmm. just couldn't even finish the 4 weeks of PT that their primary care provider prescribed because they were just in so much pain. So they'll end up with us, we'll do an epidural steroid injection, mm-hmm. that'll give them some good pain relief, then they'll go back to PT. Then they'll do their home exercises and they'll continue on that path. So usually, again, at the way it works at our facility and our primary care providers, mm-hmm. which are a big referral source for us, I would say patients are probably getting their injections within the first couple weeks of seeing us. But a lot of times, one or two injections is all they need. And if we can get them to a point of understanding that, you know, to carry this on, this isn't the solution. This is just something to kind of get you over the hump.
Right.
And we're trying to get you to feel better so you feel good enough to go out and exercise, to do the home exercise stretching mm-hmm. And a little bit of weightlifting, weight-bearing exercises. Doing those types of things that PT is suggesting and their primary care is suggesting, maybe lose some weight if they've got a really high body mass index and they need to just get that down, because otherwise you're just going to continue putting pressure on those discs and they're going to continue to herniate. Smoking is another big issue. There's multiple studies, they redo them all the time and they always come out with the same result that smokers have a much higher risk of disc herniation than non-smokers.
Really?
And so it changes the makeup of the disc in the spine and it makes it much more easy to slide out and cause disc bulges and disc herniations. So that's a big one. We try to get our patients to realize that you need to really work with your primary care provider. There's lots of options available now to try to stop smoking. So we can really we're looking at how are we going to control your back health 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 15 years from now.
Right.
Doing epidural steroid injections all the time, that's not going to be the right answer. So
it's more about learning how to change your daily habits once you can get the pain under control to start changing your normal daily activities.
Right.
All right. I've got something here called a PNB. Have we discussed that?
That is peripheral nerve block.
Okay.
And yes, that's what we were talking about with both the acute pain. And every once in a while, we'll use that in chronic pain. Sometimes there'll be a part of the body that's just, they call it a wind-up phenomenon. It doesn't sound very medical, mm-hmm. but the nerves have just gotten themselves in such a rut where they are firing all the time, even though they shouldn't be firing.
Oh, okay.
If I pinch my arm, I should have a nerve fire there that tells me, oh, that hurts if I do that. But if I just lightly touch my arm, I shouldn't have a severe pain. But some patients will they'll have developed this already where you're just barely touch their back and they're just moving like, it feels like I'm pinching their back, even though I'm just barely touching it. We have to get those nerves to break out of that. And sometimes we will use the peripheral nerve blocks that we use for surgery in a chronic pain situation to just kind of turn those nerves off for a while. And that combined with some other oral mm-hmm. medications will kind of reset the nerves and let them start over.
Just settle everything down for a little bit. All right, well, let me change gears here for just a second. We've got about 5 minutes left in the show. And I want to ask, what are you doing to help with the opioid crisis in our area?
Yep. As you know, it's a big deal everywhere mm-hmm. in the country.
It is.
This opioid epidemic has taken over. There's a lot of different reasons for it. Some of it is the amount of pills just available out in the community. Mm-hmm. That is a lot of leftover pills from surgeries that people had. So you had your shoulder surgery and maybe they prescribed you 7 to 10 days worth of opioids, mm-hmm. Taking those 3 to 4 times a day, maybe 1 to 2 pills 3 to 4 times a day. That ends up being a large pill bottle. You may, especially if you've had a peripheral nerve block or your pain control was really good, you may not have taken hardly any of those pain pills, but now you still have them.
Yeah.
And we need better ways to get rid of those because we're finding that the younger generation, they're finding these pills and people are using them that they're not intended to be used for. It's not for the person that they were prescribed for. So that's number one. If we're able to control their acute pain mm-hmm. in the surgical setting, those surgeons don't need to prescribe these long, huge doses, long lengths of time of huge doses of these medicines. So there's less of it in the community. Number two, we're exposing patients to less narcotics intraoperatively and after surgery. So we've gone through, for instance, a breast surgery. Mm-hmm. There's evidence that if you use opioids or narcotics, the risk of reoccurrence of breast cancer is much higher. So all of those surgeries will go through a completely non-narcotic experience. We'll do a block ahead of time, a peripheral nerve block. And we use all non-opioid medicines through the entirety of their stay. So their body has never been exposed to the opioids, and they never even know what that's like. It doesn't turn on any of these receptors. Some of the things they're studying right now, why certain people have, you know, different responses to opioids and why we have some addictions in people that, you know, just didn't even know that that
right,
was something.
Yes.
A lot of times it's just in hereditary-wise and you don't even realize that's a gene that's running in mm-hmm. your family. So we can do patients a favor if we're not, anytime we cannot expose them to opioids and get around that another way, still controlling their pain, but doing it via all of these other receptors and these other tools that we have. We're doing this community of service.
All right. Well, that's so interesting. And we didn't get to the iPad there, but was there anything that you wanted to talk? We have just a couple of minutes left. Was there anything that you were going to show or talk about that? Do we have
I can show
just
what
about
we
a minute
use.
Left here?
This is what we use in the clinic a lot. And again, it's just a way to show patients.
See if we can get this on camera and
what's going on. There we go. What's going on in their spine. So we can show them the back and different spots that we're working on. That's the hippo. There's the sacrum there. And so if we're looking at a sacroiliac joint, or if we can zoom in and we're gonna work at doing an injection in between this level and this level, and we can show the connective tissue on the back. So all those little arthritic areas, they have this little joint capsule around them so that we can go in there and inject. So we can do things on here and we can add the nerves and we can show patients specific nerves that are troublesome to them. So it's a really neat tool. We can look at their MRI and then we can, MRIs are hard to read for mm-hmm. patients, I find. And so you can throw the MRI picture up, but that doesn't always mean a whole lot. This little app that we use means a whole lot more because we can make that very individualized for the patients.
Well, how neat. Technology is so cool these days. You can show the patient exactly what's going on. They can understand it, get their pain under control, hopefully, and start to live normal lives. Well, it's been a pleasure talking about this with you today.
Much.
Thank you so much for getting this information out. And thank you for watching this episode of Being Well. Please tune in to our website for more information at weiu.net and click on Being Well. We'll see you next time.
Sarah Bush Lincoln Health System, supporting healthy lifestyles, eating a heart-healthy diet, staying active, managing stress, and regular checkups are ways of reducing your health risks. Proper health is important to all at Sarah Bush Lincoln Health System.
Meeting the ever-changing healthcare needs of our communities, Paris Community Hospital Family Medical Center is now Horizon Health, with the same ownership, management, providers, and employees. Horizon Health provides patient care and promotes wellness to the communities of East Central Illinois.
At HS St. Anthony's Memorial Hospital, we are at work transforming heart care, rebuilding knees and hips, delivering new generations, and focused on providing health care to you. We are HS St. Anthony's Memorial Hospital.
Carl combines clinical care, health insurance, and research in a way that solves problems today with an eye toward the future. Supported by a deep philanthropic spirit and dedicated to making life better for as many as possible.